Good afternoon and welcome to Alfred Music's webinar series, Learn, Teach, Play Online. My name is Michaela Graham, Senior Event Specialist for Alfred Music, and I will be running everything in the background for our session today. We are thrilled to host today's webinar, Using Technology to Unlock Musical Creativity with Dr. Scott Watson. Before we get started, I have just a couple of housekeeping notes for you. At the end of the webinar, we'll provide a link to the certificate of attendance for today's session. Please note the certificate of attendance will only be available for live attendees and not for the replay. If you have any questions for our presenters throughout the session, please feel free to drop them in the Q&A box and not the chat box. We love hearing your thoughts throughout the presentation, and we will have some time for Q&A at the end of today's session. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our presenter today. Dr. Scott Watson has taught instrumental and elective music in the Parkland School District in Allentown, Pennsylvania for 35 years and serves as an adjunct professor for Cairn University, among many others. He is a frequently commissioned composer with approximately 100 published pieces for band and strings and is an active clinician and guest conductor. Scott, thank you so much for being here today. I will let you take it away.
Thank you, Michaela. Alrighty, and thank you all for making time to be here and hear about some ideas for adding some creativity to the teaching you do. To get started, I'm going to share my screen with you and just mention that there's some links I'll be giving you momentarily. All right. And my email, feel free, you're in my webinar now, so we're friends. So if at some time in the future you'd like to pick my brain or send me a project some of your kids have done, maybe one of the projects that I outlined today and want to say, hey, look, this worked really cool. I'd love to hear about it. Any questions you have, feel free to follow up with an email. My website, www.scottwatsonmusic.com. is where you can find out about some of the work I'm doing in music. And if you're a band or strings person, you can hear some of my music. And then that link at the bottom is actually a link that's going to be shared with all of you by Michaela. It's a handout. If I was to do a live session, I would have given you a written handout. And that's a Google Doc handout, which is nice. If it's a Google Doc, you can make it your own. You can type in your own notes. And if you have a QR reader, you could be scanning the Scan Me QR code there, and that'll take you to the Google Doc on your smart device as well. At the end of this presentation, we're going to actually share the presentation that I'm using, so you'll have the whole thing then too. Okay, so it's been a year like no other, and part of the reason you're probably here is because you're looking for some ideas, especially to enhance the remote learning that you're doing. I know even this year, band and strings, ensemble and choral conductors, ensemble conductors are even more concerned with some of the creative projects and project-based learning and things like that, because maybe, unfortunately, their ensembles aren't meeting, but they're trying to teach music in other ways. So a lot of the ideas that are in the presentation, normally I would say they're geared more towards elective music at the high school or middle school, or general music at middle school or elementary. And then there's some bleed over into ensemble music, but I would say this year it's really for everybody. So, you guys have been adapting and I have as well. I'm a K-12 teacher myself, primarily. And it's just been a year like none other, having Zoom music classes, Zoom faculty meetings, creating virtual ensemble videos. Some people have done that, even though Eric Whitaker used to be the only one who had done those virtual ensembles, it seemed. Now it seems like everybody or a lot of people have done them. So good for you and for your heart. I just wanted to share this cartoon that I think encapsulates what's going on. This doctor's saying, hey, you have a slightly enlarged heart, but that's because you're a music teacher. So kudos to you all. Another thing about all these screens of squares that we've been looking at, I don't know if you had the same kind of eerie feeling like you've seen this before when you started like every day getting online and Google Meets and Zoom and seeing these squares. It dawned on me, I have actually seen this before, and it's sort of like an old thing that's become new. So let's move on. The presentation that I'm doing, Using Technology to Unlock Musical Creativity, It's based on a book I wrote a few years ago. It's published by Oxford University Press, and it's a summary of philosophical underpinnings, pedagogical methods that sort of marry project-based learning with music teaching. And I didn't even write the book until I'd been doing it for years. But then when I did, what I did was I picked the home runs, the best projects that I had been doing with my students, and put them in the book as examples. But the book is more about the pedagogy of teaching this style of project-based learning and creativity, and technology is a big part of it. Since then, there's been even more projects that other people have shared with me. And I think a second edition is not gonna be too long to come out. But anyway, I encourage you, if you're interested in hearing more about the methodology of teaching, how can you teach these lessons, implement them, maybe consider the book. Okay, so why emphasize creativity? We're living in a time that Dan Pink, in his book, A Whole New Mind, describes as the conceptual age, right? We went through the agricultural age of farmers, the industrial age of factory workers around the pre-turn of the century, 20th century, the information age in the mid-20th to current, almost till recently. But the conceptual age emphasizes creativity. And I can't think of another person that epitomizes the time that we live in, other than Steve Jobs, or the fellow that's the head of Tesla or Amazon. There are all these people who have these creative visions, in addition to having expertise in another area. So I think creativity is we have no apology to make about how we want kids to start thinking creatively. Other things that put creativity right in front of us, whether it's your college, education classes that introduce you to Bloom's taxonomy, where, things like understanding and applying knowledge, that's like teaching half notes and whole notes or two beats, right? That's kind of basic, but actually creating with those materials, that learning actually has been proven to last longer. Kids are more motivated intrinsically by it. So at the top of Bloom's, or at least the most recent iteration of his taxonomy, creating is up there as the most sophisticated expression of learning. And then, of course, the National Core Art Standards came out a few years ago, and we see that creating is even one of the pillars, right? In the previous MENC, NAFME standards 3 and 4 had to do with composing, arranging, and improvising. And so they were part of, 9 standards. Now it's one of 4 pillars. So creativity is really getting a front row seat in our discipline as well. If you look at this slide of what employers are looking for, back in 2015, creativity still made the top 10, but look at it in 2020, it's the third highest ranking skill. So again, no apologies for why we emphasize creativity. I wanted to share a couple actual expressions of creativity at different levels. This, what you're looking at now, this picture, is a drummer I had. His name was Brock, and he was a fourth grade drummer at Citroni Elementary School a few years back. And the dad sent me this picture after like 2 lessons, after having had 2 drum lessons. The kid went home on his whiteboard and wrote all of this. I mean, it just blew me away, but it didn't blow me away in a sense, because I've noticed over the years that as soon as you teach a kid 2 or 3 notes on their instrument, they come in the next week or two and they're playing little melodies that they've made up. So I really do believe kids have this creative impulse, and any time that you can tap into that and bring creativity into what you're teaching, whether it's band like what I teach primarily, or whether it's elective music, general music, anytime you can bring creativity in, and especially the younger, the better, the more you'll capture their intrinsic motivation. Here's another example of kids writing some rudimental, this is a drum lesson again, where kids wrote this cadence, and I just did the notating. I didn't actually make up any of these notes. These are things that they could play, but they couldn't express themselves. So I had to be the scribe and dictate it. But that's actually, again, something that second year drummers made up in a lesson. So just a little bit of bringing creativity, even though primarily when I'm teaching a band lesson, I'm thinking about, teaching them technique and proficiency on their instrument. But there's just little moments that you can add creativity to the mix. I want to play for you a short video of, again, first-year band students. And again, these are percussionists. First-year band students who, this wasn't an assignment. This wasn't anything that I was doing special. It was just they came into their lesson, and this one gal had written a percussion trio that she wanted to share with me. And we worked on it. And, you know, what was cool is we were able to work on stuff that they were doing anyway, rhythms that they were learning anyway, but with something that they had actually written. Let me just share this briefly.
Wait a second. So here is Julia's original composition, When the Sun Comes Up, for triangle, snare drum, and bass drum. Okay, ready? One, two, ready, go. Two and three and four and one, two and three and four and one, two and three, four, one, two, now back to the beginning, and one, two and three and four and one, two and three and four and one, two and three, four, one, two, now we're going on, and one, two and three, four, one, two, three, and then repeat it, one, two and three, four, one, going on, snare solo, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, and four, one, two, three, four, one, and two.
I don't know if you can look at the music. You can see that they hand drew the staff with like a ruler or something. It wasn't even staff paper, right?
Four, one, two, and you guys are back in.
Anyway, you get the idea. But my point is that they are so, they students want to create. I want to show you something on the complete other end of the spectrum, kind of like the alpha to the omega. Those were first year band students. What I'm going to share with you now is something that a student in my AP music theory class wrote as a project. So this is a high school student who's a senior at the time and is one of our, you know, more sophisticated musicians in the what we call the A wing at Parkland High School, where we have our band, chorus, and orchestra and elective music classes. So here's an AP music student wrote this piece, a setting of Psalm 12. I'll play a little bit of it for you. Isn't that great? And again, I was very proud of that student. But I will say that he's not the only student who've written really, really impressive expressions of their creativity. Technology turned out to play a big role in bringing him to that point, and some other things that are mentioned on the screen in front of you right now. So what you're looking at is a summary of the six principles of musical creativity. That is the that pedagogy framework that I mentioned. In the lessons I teach, I try to employ these. And I believe if you employ them or make as many of them as you can part of a lesson that you teach, it'll end up facilitating some great creativity. So I'm going to show you each of these principles one by one with some actual projects, and I'll point you to some lesson plans that you can download if you want, and some software that you could use that's free, mostly cloud-based software that you could use to do these lessons. And some of the lessons I think are real home runs. They've always yielded great results for the students I've worked with. And one thing I'll mention about the lessons that you're going to see today, in many cases, they're adaptable. So I might use them with a high school music theory class, but I've also, for a couple of years ago, I taught at a summer band camp at Penn State University with middle schoolers. I did the same lesson, but just hosed it down a little bit, worked really well. And some of these lessons, when I've taught a creativity composing and arranging elective with fourth and fifth graders in our summer band and strings camp in the Parkland School District, I've used some of these same lessons with those students. And they work well too, so they're adaptable. And anyway, just really briefly, say employ student agency is number one. Offer compelling examples that inspire. Employ parameters, that's like limitations. I know that seems weird, but you'll see. Why does parameters having limitations help kids be more creative? There's actually a connection. Anyway, facilitate experimentation and improvisation. Foster revision. Revision is a big part of excellence. And then employing exhibition, you know, having some kind of a seeing, a viewing, a sharing Okay, let's jump into it. And excuse me, because I know I'm a very type A. I talk fast. I always tell my students, you got to listen fast. But I'm just there's just so much great stuff to share with you. And so if I do talk a little fast, maybe when we have the questions, you could say, hey, could you explain that again, Scott? So I apologize. Anyway, so employ student agency. What do I mean by that? Well, when student choice plays a role, students are more intrinsically motivated. We all know that. So it could be something very incidental, like just telling the kids they get to choose the title. I know when I've done some little composition projects, sometimes choosing the title, you know, maybe a kid calls it the silly spider or something like that, that they just think is kind of goofy. And that just makes them happy that they got to choose the title. So whether it's choosing the title, choosing instruments, choosing loops in a loop-based project, maybe they get to choose the tempo and other things like that. Maybe they get to choose the certain software allows them to change styles or genre. Or if they are doing a podcast and they get to choose what musical examples go in that podcast or what artist or composers they're going to feature, anything that basically allows them to share themselves is going to be a winner. So as an example of that, I wanted to share a project I call The Sound of My Name. And this particular project, you need some kind of what technically is called a pattern-based matrix sequencer, but it really isn't that complicated. What it means is you have a grid. You know, squares up mean pitch, and squares left to right mean duration, where they occur in time, temporal. And there's lots of pattern-based pattern matrix sequencers like this. What you're looking at actually in that video to the right there, that is in Chrome Music Lab, which is, if you don't know about Chrome Music Lab, you definitely want to check that out. Chrome Music Lab is a suite of very niche, kind of limited focus apps, but one of them is called Song Maker. And it's this little sequencer where you can choose a couple different instruments, and it limits the note choices to like a pentatonic scale, so that in a sense, kids can't pick a wrong note. Another one, Tone Matrix Redux, is there too. So both of those are linked on my handout and on this presentation that you'll get. But I'm going to play the video that explains the lesson. Hopefully you'll get the idea of what is the Sound of My Name project and how that would be done. You could do this literally with any grade, K to 12. I usually do it with elementary age. The Sound of My Name project depends on the truism that repetition lends intelligibility to music. There's been a lot of neuroscientific research that proves this, that when something is repeated, it gives it a musical identity and makes it more attractive to listeners to a point. We're going to use Chrome Music Lab's Song Maker to demonstrate. This is a project students from elementary level on up can do. They would basically use the grid to click, hold, and drag to draw their name. So my name is Scott, so I would do something like this, S-C-O-T-T. Now, a lot of trained musicians would say, well, this is so random, how could it sound musical? The truth is, once we start repeating it, it's going to pick up a rhythm of its own. Let's try it right now. Right, and it does have kind of a random sound to it, but when we start hearing it again and again and again, I'm going to put my last initial W for Watson. And I'm going to just randomly hit some percussion beats too. Add those. And again, they're part of the repetition that we're going to hear. Change that percussion from electronic to congas, and change the marimba as the main instrument to strings. Okay. And some would say we have an attractive piece that doesn't sound that dissimilar from some contemporary concert art music. Okay, and I only half jokingly say that You know, I've worked with composition majors at universities, and their music doesn't sound all that dissimilar from what you just heard. So anyway, that's the sound of my name, and getting to put their name or their phone number or their favorite number or whatever, their favorite caller, putting something in there that is a handle to them. By the way, any of these lesson plans, if you click on the actual lesson plan title, like when I click on the sound of my name, it'll take you to the actual lesson plan that has, you know, all the steps and how long I think it will take and so forth. So I'm not going to show you that with each one of these, but I just wanted to show that to you now, so that when you get these slides later, if you want to get the actual lesson plan, just click on the title of the lesson. Okay. One thing I want to mention too is that when I started doing that lesson, I was using an app called iNudge. Came out around 2009. By 2000 and I forget what, 2015 maybe, that app went out of business or whatever. It stopped appearing. And then Tone Matrix, I discovered, did more or less the same thing. Wasn't as colorful looking. And then more recently, Tone Matrix Redux. Since Tone Matrix only works with Java, which on Chrome, if you're using the browser Chrome, Tone Matrix won't work anymore because it doesn't run Java. So anyway, you might, and Chrome Music Lab also works, the one I just showed you, Song Maker. Okay, another project that helps kids express themselves is a project I call My Favorite Things. So My Favorite Things is where students get to pick an artist and share why that music is so compelling. And that's basically the lesson. Just tell me why it's so compelling. It's not a research paper. You don't have to go on, you know, Wikipedia or do any research, unless you want to. All I want to hear from you is, why do you like this music so much? And I use GarageBand because we have it in the lab where I teach, but you could use Soundtrap, which is a great like online DAW. DAW stands for Digital Audio Workstation. So Soundtrap or BandLab is another great DAW that's cloud-based. And both of them have a free version, but if you're using it in schools because of COPPA compliance, you probably want to get like a Soundtrap for Education, which is very, very cheap. It's like $1 a student or maybe $2 a student. I think it's like, anyway, it's very cheap. But you could use it with 13 and older. Older than 13, you could use, like I do, some of these web apps. You don't need to necessarily have that. Anyway, so if you have a DAW, if you have an app like GarageBand or Soundtrap, honestly, even with Audacity, you could do this lesson. You have students pick three samples of the artist's music, you know, and talk about them. So maybe a microphone or the built-in mic on the device they're using is necessary to you know, add a voiceover narration. The voiceover narrations can be somewhat informal. I ask my students to do an outline or actually write out a script, but I tell them if you write a script, no more than 150 words. We're not talking about a research paper. I just want to hear what you like about their music. And, you know, revision will end up playing a big part of this. Maybe in their first draft, there's some, you know, one of the clips is way, way too long, for instance, and it just seems out of proportion with the whole thing. Or maybe their voice is too soft and we have to set their levels. But I wanted to, I'll click again on this one more, just so you can see. There's the lesson plan for how to do this podcast. And it includes things like, you know, a screenshot of what it might look like with all those sound samples in. So this is like a middle school and older lesson. There's a link to a video, and there's a video that literally explains every step in how to create this podcast. So it's already ready for remote learning and so forth. Let me play for you a couple examples so you can hear what these podcasts sound like, or at least.
This song is called Snow in the Bluff by J. Cole. This song addresses the racial inequalities that we're seeing today and different people's perspectives on it.
Be thinking I'm deep, intelligent, fooled by my college degree. My IQ is average, there's a young lady out there, she way smarter than me. I scroll through her timeline in these wild times and I started to read. She mad at these capitalists, mad at these murder police. She mad at that ignorance, she wear a heart on her sleeve.
Got me up all night.
This is Power Trip by J. Cole featuring Miguel. This is a love song about his ex-girlfriend and how she basically...
Okay, and let me go back to that. I wanted to share at least one more. Here's another one.
Hi, this is Megan, and welcome to It Wouldn't Be Christmas Without, a podcast featuring some of my favorite holiday tunes. In my family, the Christmas season begins the minute we finish cleaning up Thanksgiving dinner. After we finish the pumpkin pie, we sit down to watch A Charlie Brown Christmas, The first song I'm going to share is Vince Guaraldi's Christmas Time Is Here, which is featured at the end of the special while all the children are skating on a pond and snow is falling peacefully.
Okay. Let me just play very little bit of each the other room.
Hello and welcome to the Jazz Cast. This is Elena Strock, and today we are greeted by Buddy Rich's Big Swing Face.
Okay, today, so we got J. Cole's, we got Christmas music that I remember from my youth. We have Buddy Rich. Let's see this next one.
Oh, Cinnamon, where you gonna run to? Cinnamon, where you gonna run to?
If there was one word to describe Nina Simone, it would be power.
Right, and Nina Simone, and let's see what this last one is.
Hi, and welcome to Jam Master Jay's Tribute to the Newmans.
Tribute to the Newmans. So that's all the film composers, Alfred Newman, David Newman, Thomas Newman. Anyway, this project is so eclectic because it could be literally any. I've had people do podcasts on the theremin, on Icelandic pop music, on jazz guitarist Yngwie Malmsteen. I mean, it's all over the place, but it's a really great way to get to know kids. And also, by the time they get done this project, they really know how to edit audio well. So I really like the project and commend it to you that work with older students. All right, let's move on to the second principle to unlock creativity, and that's offer compelling examples. I just did that, right? I just shared with you what I thought were some compelling examples. But at the beginning of every project that I teach, I let students see an exemplar. I let them see, number one, what does this project look like? What do you have to do to have done the project correctly or successfully? And then what are some projects that if I play for students, they'll say, you know, I knew that kid. He was in my class last year. If he could do it, maybe I can do it too. So it's good to use student examples. And it also just inspires and helps kids be motivated that they hear something really attractive and compelling. And then they say to themselves, "Ooh, I'd kind of like to do that myself. I want to be part of that." So for a lot of reasons, compelling examples are great. One thing that I will say is the first time I do a project, if I don't have a student example, because it's new, I do the project myself. By the way, even if I do have an example that I can already share, I always do the project myself for a bunch of reasons, which we'll talk about. In fact, I'm going to share with you a very brief video by Jeff Robin, founder of High Tech High in San Diego and one of the leaders in the project-based learning movement. And this little video kind of explains briefly what project-based learning is, but listen especially to his commending about why you should do the project yourself. And then we'll talk about what are some reasons that doing the project yourself is helpful. So let's just listen.
Project-based learning goes something like this. You figure out what you want the students to learn. It could be the standards or it could be your own creation, and you develop a project. You reverse engineer the content into the project. Then you do the project yourself. That way you know the pitfalls, you know what the deliverables are going to be, you know what tasks are involved. Then you introduce it to the students, and then you move forward and you have a management scheme to get the students to do their work. You want to design it so that nobody falls through the cracks and nobody games the system. You know how to support them because you've done it yourself, and through revision and critique, you create a beautiful project. Then it's exhibition. You really need to have an exhibition because that's what makes it real. The students should be done at least a week or two before exhibition, so you have time to think about it, time to review your work, time to talk about it. In between finishing the project and exhibition night, you can do a lot of different things. You could show your work to other student groups. You can show a movie to your students that has something to do with your project. You could do reading or research or even a lecture to talk about things that you maybe feel like you didn't cover enough, but you really wanted to hit on and the project didn't allow you to. And then on exhibition night, everybody's cool, calm, and collected, and they have a beautiful exhibition. And just one more thing. Do the project yourself. Do the project yourself. It'll pay off huge in the end if you just do the project yourself first.
Do you think that he's really interested in having you do the project yourself? Yes, of course. So I don't know if you can just think to yourself, what are some reasons? How would doing the project myself help me? Help this endeavor? Things like you'll end up encountering the same pitfalls your students will. And you can say to yourself, wow, if I'm an adult accomplished musician and I encountered these pitfalls, I wonder what my sixth graders. So you might end up deciding to take twice as many class periods to do the project rather than the three that you had set aside. Or maybe you decide that you're not going to have them do quite as many tasks, or you're not going to have the project be as deep. I'll give you an example. There's a project that I do that involves arranging a MIDI file. And when I first started teaching it, I had the students just go online and pick the MIDI file that they liked. I told them how they could search for MIDI files and then find a MIDI file they liked, whether it was Beatles or Bach. It turned out they could spend a whole week searching for MIDI files. So then I decided, okay, I'm going to just point them to certain sites. And they have to choose a MIDI file from these sites. Well, now they could spend 3 days doing that. So then I thought, okay, I'm going to download a collection of 10 or 12 MIDI files and let them choose one of those. And it turned out some of those projects worked out really well. Some of them didn't work as well. Finally, I found 8 that really worked well. No matter which of the 8 they chose, it would work out really well. And that's where I'm at now. It took me a lot of trial and error to get to the point, but that was just me doing the project myself. The first time I did it, I realized, man, I just had a fun time spending a couple hours searching for the MIDI files. I'll bet you this is going to really hang up my students. So anyway, doing the project yourself is really important. We're going to go on to this third principle, and this is one of the most important and significant ones, employing parameters or limitations. And here's the paradox. This idea that if you give boundaries to students, it's going to actually stifle their creativity, it's false. If you give the right boundaries to students, it actually helps them move forward. Because when you tell some student, listen, I'm going to let you have infinite numbers of choices of all sorts of things, a lot of students who aren't used to creating actually freeze up and they can't move forward. So I know it seems counterintuitive, but giving students boundaries, having some parameters, does help them move forward. Now, there are some parameters that do lead to contrived expression. So for instance, if you're doing a percussion trio composition project with your middle school general music or your fifth graders or fourth graders, and you say, for these three instruments, I want you to write a trio, and you can only use whole notes and quarter notes, because that's all we've done so far, whole notes and quarter notes. What's going to end up happening is most of the projects are going to actually sound very similar, and they're going to be one unremarkable version of the same project after another. So there are some contrivances that can kibosh a project, but most of these parameters will actually help students move forward. The reason I call it Stravinsky's paradox is because in the late 30s, Stravinsky actually came to Harvard University and presented a series of lectures that then ended up becoming part of a book that was published. And this is actually Stravinsky's words. He says, the creator's function is to sift the elements he receives from her, for humanity activity must impose limits upon itself. The more art is controlled, limited, worked over, the more it is free. And he goes on to explain how he personally likes to stay inside sort of these walls, and he might bump up against the walls and push the envelope a little bit, but having those walls helps him move forward. And I found that the same as a composer myself, is to have some parameters when I have a commission, knowing what are the limitations, actually helps me fulfill the project. So just think about that, and I'll give you a couple examples. Probably if I was to tell you of the presentation that you're viewing right now, what's going to be one of the most home run of the projects you could do, it's this pedal point duet. I started doing it about 20 years ago, and it has yielded some of the most wonderful music from students who have absolutely no theoretical knowledge, or they don't really have a background in composition. But just using the parameters of this project ends up allowing students to create some really neat stuff. So I'd say if you're looking for one project, and the thing, again, that I mentioned earlier, it's adaptable. You could do this project with fourth graders. You could do this project with university composition majors, and you can do this project with anywhere in between. And I've taught all of those levels, and I've used this project with all of those types of students. And it just has a lot of flexibility. So the idea is, and again, you can click on the title pedal point, you'll see the whole lesson plan, but the idea is you're going to use some kind of a notation app, and I'd recommend NoteFlight, for instance. It's great, and you can get a free version of it, or you can get a very low-cost educator version of it, and you ask students to create a duet for two like instruments, like two recorders or two marimbas or two clarinets, whatever. The reason you do two like instruments is then you don't have to worry about transposition. And you tell them that one of the parts has to stay on the same note primarily. Now, I do let kids, once they start working on the project and they ask about exceptions, then I'll say, oh, sure, if you think it sounds good, but primarily just stay on the same note. So that makes writing one of the projects very easy. One of the parts, I'm sorry, very easy. So say the bottom part of the duet is just going to be do, 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 do. You know, maybe a rhythm that an ostinato rhythm or a long sustain or whatever. The top part's going to explore some kind of melodic contour. It turns out that just is a recipe for successful music making. So let's watch this video, and you'll see an example of one of the pedal point duets done by, I think, a fourth or a fifth grader. Now there they break the pedal, and that's okay, right? This little dialogue. But we're back to the pedal here. Okay. Now, what's great is if you can actually have these be performed live. So for instance, when I did this as part of the summer band and strings camp, I would actually have students write for two of the instrument they play and with a buddy, and then they would actually perform it. We would maybe pick one or two of them to actually play it in our end of the week exhibition for parents. We'd have a parent concert at the end of the week of band camp, and we'd play these as well. So it becomes not just theoretical, they're actually performing it. With my high school AP music theory class, I have them write for instruments that are in the class or in the A-wing, and then we get live performances and record them as well. This is an example of one of the AP music theory students' pedal point duets that was performed by students in the A-wing. So now that we're up to high school, we're not worried about the two like instruments. They can be transposing instruments because AP music theory kids know about transposition. And this has a little bit more of an expressive form. It's a da capo form, ABA. Let me just play a little bit of this one. Notice the pedal is just an ostinato rhythm in the clarinet. Now here in the B section, we're going to flip the pedal up to the top part so that the clarinet can have some more interest in its material. And now the pedal is no longer an ostinato. The pedal is a long sustain, which is another type of pedal. And then, of course, we return to the A section. Okay. And as you can imagine, you know, university composers do that same project and write even more expressive music. Some neat ways to inspire ostinato rhythms for the pedal is to ask students to, you know, tell you about their favorite sports team, right? And there's a really neat shortcut in Note Flight. If you just type the letter R for repeat, whatever measure you've selected will just all of a sudden repeat itself. I'll show you that in a second. You could use food for the ostinato, right? Grape soda, apple pie, or chocolate strawberry. So anyway, let me just show you that repeat shortcut in this short video. Here's a nifty little shortcut that comes in handy a lot with Note Flight, and that is the shortcut for repeat is simply to hit the key R on your QWERTY keyboard, R for repeat. So for instance, we have a rhythm here. We want it to be an ostinato. I want it to appear in the next four measures, let's say, or the next eight measures. I just select it, and then I type the letter R once, twice, three times, four times, five times, six. Okay, and you get the idea there. By the way, did you notice that rhythm was Philadelphia Eagles? Because that's my team. Anyway, although we're sorry to lose Carson Wentz, apparently. Okay, number three, the parameters. And you can see with that project, the pedal point duet, you say, hey, like this to say for an elementary, it can only be 4 to 8 measures. The bottom part has to be on the first scale degree, or not even, you can just say a note. It has to be on such and such a note. We're doing recorders, The bottom part has to be G, but you can choose any rhythm you like. You could make up an ostinato and repeat it, but the bottom part has to stay on that G. The top part has to also start on and end on the G, start and end on the G, but in between the start and end, let's explore some kind of a melodic contour, maybe an arch. So you end up teaching some cool music. You've got these parameters that help keep the project successful. All right, number four, facilitate experimentation and improvisation. When I teach composition to university composers, I tell them that there's composition and there's pre-composition. Things like sketching to me are part of the composition, the pre-composition project. Even just thinking about a project is pre-composition. And experimenting, improvising at the keyboard, just playing around with the software you're going to use to create the project, that's pre-composition. And that's an important part and an often overlooked part of the creative process. So again, if you can think of an age-appropriate way to just build that kind of Google Genius hour, just a little bit of time where students can have fun playing with note flight but not actually writing anything, have fun playing with Soundtrap or GarageBand but without actually having the project to do, just in the front end of the project, that will actually unlock some ideas. And I think it's wise to build that into the project. Use your judgment, but experiment and improvisation. And sorry, let's go to the next slide. Okay, so one of the greatest apps for just having a fun time fooling around is Incredibox. If you don't know about Incredibox, it's a virtual beatboxing app. You basically drag these icons onto the chest of these different characters, and then that character starts, performing the rhythm, the sort of the groove element that's represented by that icon. So the icons are kind of like loops. And so it's kind of like virtual beatboxing with loops. Let's watch a little video with Incredibox.
All right, this is Incredibox version 4, the virtual beatboxer. The character gets one of these icons and he starts performing. Over here we have beats. In fact, let's just get a bunch of beats going here.
And see how I'm just dragging it onto the character, and then the character,
and if there's something you don't like,
begins playing it.
You can take the guy out. And then here's some, they're called effects, but these are actually some bass lines.
I'm going to keep moving because you could just spend all day just on Incredibox. But anyway, you can have a lot of fun with that. Some teachers I know use that Incredibox up on a big screen and have kids come up to the single computer that they have in their classroom, but they're projecting it on a whiteboard or on a projector, and then the kids get to choose the loops one at a time. Sometimes it's done at the end of a class as like a reward. All right, I just want to show you another example for experimentation. I'm not going to go too deep into this, but just say that I started doing a project a few years ago it's again at the older level kids that I teach, done great projects where I asked them to just record individual sounds like this. Right, like that just crushing a bottle, or this one is, I think, somebody ripping a Velcro strip. Right, so we take all those individual sounds and I have students arrange them in a DAW, like Soundtrap or GarageBand, and they come up with their own beats that sound like this. Right, or this. Sorry, didn't mean to do that one again. Okay, you get the idea. I want to also just put in a plug that notation doesn't have to be traditional, conventional. There's a lot of different ways people have notated music through the years. And if notation is a hang up for students, like in that last project, if you're doing something where students have these found sounds or body percussion sounds, they don't necessarily have to be able to notate it. They could record it. They could just find some kind of a graphic notation and then perform them for in cooperative learning groups, they could perform them for the other class members. And that's your exhibition, by the way. Okay, foster revision. Revision is a huge part of project-based learning. whether it's in person or whether it's remote, you do some coaching, you kind of get some peer feedback. Students get maybe a task list of what do I need to do or what might I do? What could I consider doing to make the piece even stronger? You might have to model at first what offerings, things like praise, right? That's one type of feedback is praise. Students or me telling the kid, oh, I really like that. I really responded well to that. I found that very compelling. Or criticism, you know, that one track I could barely hear. Is there a way you could turn up the volume? You know, criticism would be in a healthy way, another form of feedback. And then suggestions or for your consideration. These are kind of neutral, like, hey, that's awesome. I really enjoyed that. Would you consider this too? Just think about it, right? So by the way, if I could give you a short list of books to help your teaching or inform your teaching, Ron Berger's An Ethic of Excellence. You know, ways to get students to just embrace a culture of excellence. It's a very short book, but it really is, it's got some powerful ideas in there. And revision is probably the biggest idea, is that none of us in real life, in our jobs, none of us turn in our first draft. And when students turn in their first draft, it just makes sense it's going to be mediocre. Whereas if they turn in their fourth draft or their second draft, it's going to be so much more excellent. So just consider that. This project, again, I'll let you click on the title and explore it yourself, but this is the project I mentioned where you take a MIDI file, put it in a DAW. You know, if you just drag and drop a MIDI file into a program like GarageBand or Soundtrap or BandLab, it'll have all the notes there. All the students have to do is then change the instruments, add drum beats, add bass loops, and have a lot of fun with it. So that's just a quick summary of it. I can use this project to really teach some great arranging principles like layering and so forth. But for time's sake, I'm going to keep moving. And this is, again, another older project. But employing exhibition, I do want to mention that if you don't have some kind of way of sharing what you're doing at the end of the activity or the end of the project, kids are not going to be as motivated to do excellent work. It doesn't have to be any big deal. It could be something like, hey, for class today, I'm going to give you guys about 20 minutes to explore different sounds, different software sounds in GarageBand, and, you know, see what the pianos sound like, see what the basses sound like, see what the synthesizers sound like. And then at the end of 20 minutes, I'd like each of you to share your favorite sound. And all they have to do is basically, you know, play just a note or two. This is what the sound sounds like. You know, oh, that's really cool. Man, that's really reflective. It has a lot of reverb on it. And you start like using language to respond to the music and to talk about what they're hearing. That's a very like easy way to have just a little, you know, in-class sharing. And then on the other end of the spectrum, maybe the whole class is going to produce a CD and you're going to release that CD to the community. Or maybe you're going to have an evening where parents come out and see stuff. Or maybe you're going to have, you know, take advantage of bringing some of your favorite teachers' classes into your room, and they're going to be your audience. And you'll do an informants right in the class where students introduce their podcasts and then get to answer questions. Things like that. These are examples of various exhibitions that I've been part of, you know, film festivals, CDs, online things as well, and student performances of traditionally notated music, things like that. This is an example of an exhibition where we had in my music production class, everybody was challenged to write a jingle that would encourage kids to wash their hands, right? That's all the rage right now, right? So this is actually the winner of the contest, which they got a free breakfast. They got to choose a free breakfast for the class that was donated by the nurses in the school district, because then the nurses ended up using this song that year to encourage. This was back when we had one of the prior viruses that wasn't quite so awful, but it was still something that everybody was talking about, washing their hands. So let me play you just a little bit of this.
If your hands are dirty, you got something to do. Better scrub both your palms in between fingers too, for at least 20 seconds so your friends don't get sick. If you still feel unsure, I can give you the trick. You should
wash your hands. Wash your hands.
You get the idea. Another project that, again, is going to be in the presentation if you're interested in doing this. This is another home run. My kids love doing it. And my son did this, I think, with his sixth grade general music. My son teaches general music as well. He's a chorus teacher. And also they enjoyed it. So the idea is that you take some audio. I have some audio where I got a good voice over actor kind of guy to narrate just a little scene, kind of like a comic book graphic novel kind of scene where there's lots of helicopters crashing and grappling hooks being shot at windows and you know, there's all sorts of urban noise and everything. So you basically take that audio, which is already done for the kids, and then they add sound effects to bring the audio to life. It's an audiobook, right? And then another thing I'll have them do is use loops to just put some, you know, a bed of music that creates the mood. So the music doesn't end up being a big part of the project, but it does help enhance it a little bit. Kids love doing this project. So that's the Batman audiobook scene. And again, you can get the audio even from my document. There's if you click on the title of the lesson, you'll see a link to the audio itself, and you're welcome to use that. There's a whole list of musical creativity web apps. I have more than 50 apps like NoteFlight, but things like Groove Pizza, Chrome Music Lab, JS Box, Google Doodle, which is cool, the Beatbox, Blob Opera, which is hilarious if you haven't seen that, Soundtrap, Drumbit, and on and on and on. I have about 50 different web-based, cloud-based music apps that when you click on the link, it'll take you to that list, and there they are. And then each of these has a little, it's like a curated list of all the web apps that I've found that are really cool for creativity. The ones that are in bold are the ones I like the most. And when you click on the title, it'll take you to the website for those apps. So just have fun exploring them and maybe pick one to do a simple little creative project with your students. I'm going to just say this about assessment. If you feel like you have to assess, try to make a rubric so that it's tangible things. Only for older students, you know, things like, you know, the aesthetic kind of subjective stuff, try not to make that a big part of it, because in the end, kids aren't doing these projects because they care about the grade as much as they just want to share their own selves, their own creative selves. And if you can build that pedagogy framework around it, you'll find that the grade doesn't even matter. They're not doing it for the grade. But the task lists or the rubrics will help you grade it. And you know, comments, I think, would be the one thing I'd say that means so much, is if you put a few words like, man, I really like that project. Michaela, you have, you know, wonderful sensibilities about proportion. Just putting like a sentence like that on an assessment means so much more than even their grade. So encourage you to think about that. Anyway, we're going to take questions. I'm going to turn it back over to Michaela. I do encourage you to connect with me. If you're a band person, check out my music I've written in the Alfred band world. And if you haven't checked out my YouTube channel, I have literally hundreds of videos, more than 60 just on music theory topics, or more than 25 on different GarageBand features. So some of that might be able to be incorporated into your remote learning, just as prepackaged lessons. So you might consider that as well. Okay, so this is when I guess I turn it back over to Michaela.
So I'm going to go over to the Q&A. I only see one question from Greg here. Will we get the apps?
Will we get the apps? Well, most of them are free. So for instance, NoteFlight, you could go get a NoteFlight account right now. And the free version of NoteFlight allows you to have 9 scores for free. So with my AP Music Theory students, when I do, I don't think I do as many as 9 projects in the whole year using NoteFlight creative projects. But if we did use more, what I would ask them to do is to just delete the first one and then add that. So that would be one way to get NoteFlight for free. Eventually, you might want to have your school pay for NoteFlight, which NoteFlight Learn is not very expensive at all. I think it's something like, you know, you pay, I don't even want to quote it, but it's a very low amount for like hundreds of students. But most of the apps that are on that last doc I showed that has like more than 50 creative apps, most of those apps like Incredibox literally are free. There's not even a pay version of them. Chrome Music Lab is only free. There isn't a pay version of that. So some of them like Soundtrap that are really, really well implemented, and they're very intuitive too. You hardly have to look at it. There's no instruction book. You just maybe occasionally have to look at an FAQ doc on it, but mostly it's just intuitive, like Google Docs. You know, you don't have to really learn how to use Google Docs from a class. It's just almost intuitive. So most of them are intuitive. Most of them are free. And they all sort of have great potential for creative projects. So if that, I think that's what you're asking is, where do I get these apps? Just go to their website. And most of them, you don't even have to register for. You just by visiting the site, you're actually using the app. They're cloud-based apps.
Definitely. And I will say I have used Blob Opera before, and it is absolutely fantastic. That one is just a hoot. I love it. All right. A few more questions here from Brian. Hi, Dr. Watson. When having kids improvise, explore in different software before starting a project, do you introduce the project and parameters beforehand or just let them freeform explore, then introduce the project and its parameters?
Okay, great question. And hi, Brian. Yeah, so first of all, let me just say headphones, or earbuds or whatever. If you're doing a lot of this kind of exploring, experimenting, you don't want to have kids like spread out around the room with Chromebooks, actually with the audio in the room. You want to have them listening via their own ear monitor system. So that's something that, again, maybe you have to ask PTO to give you some, you know, you can, on Amazon, you could have Amazon Prime deliver you a set of, 30 headphones that cost $7 each, and maybe your PTO pays for that if you don't have it in your budget. But some of the projects, some of the deeper projects, I do present the project first so that they sort of know what it is they're fooling around with. Some, like My Favorite Sound, I do a thing called My Favorite Sounds, where I ask exactly that lesson that I outlined, where I just want students to explore the software instrument sounds in GarageBand. Could be Soundtrap, could be BandLab, or any of those online DAWs too. And I just want them to sort of get to know the instruments, so that in a project that's going to be next, they know what the what instruments sound really cool and what instruments actually sound kind of lame and aren't so usable. And so we do the My Favorite Sounds. And I always, like every year, I don't know why I do this, I always start that project thinking I'm going to let them just fool around and experiment with the sounds. And then after 20 or so minutes, just share their favorite sound. And I always end up doing it thinking it's going to be a one period, you know, a 45 minute kind of thing. And the kids end up digging, exploring the sounds, and then they'll like kind of elbow their neighbor and say, oh, listen to this. And next thing you know, they're like sharing headphones, which I don't know if that's so good this year, but it turns out I end up sometimes extending it to 2 or even 3 days of just doing that My Favorite Sounds, where there's no real goal except for what sound do you like the best. So I would say with some of the projects, just let them have fun and maybe demonstrate yourself having fun. Like maybe you find a sound that you think is cool and you stop the class after 5 minutes and say, folks, you got to hear this sound. And then you play like a cool dome, 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 like a fat synth bass, you know, just play that like that Michael Jackson, bass line for them. And they're like, whoa, that's cool. And then say, okay, go put your headphones back on, go explore, you know. So I think kind of sharing your enthusiasm for that whole creative process is helpful too.
All right. I think we're just going to do 2 more questions here from Michelle. Are there any websites or apps that you like for theory enrichment for beginning or middle school music students?
Well, for sure, musictheory.net, I think, is probably the most well implemented, and it's free. There is an app like on the App Store that's 99 cents, I think. But musictheory.net has both kind of like presentations of like how do you build a scale, and you could use it as on a whiteboard. You could use it to teach, or you could screen record yourself using it and put that movie in Schoology or Google Classroom. Or there are all sorts of drills, and they're customizable. So say you're working on something like intervals or key signatures, you could say, I only want it to drill the kids on major key signatures, treble clef, and only up to 3 sharps and 3 flats. So you could set the parameters, and then it gives you a URL link to that drill that you've made, that quiz you've made, and then you could embed that quiz into your learning system. So you don't have to just send them to the site. You can actually use some of the stuff from musictheory.net on the site. Teoria is another one, but I think it looks a little more heady. And for the most young students, honestly, if you check out a couple of my YouTube videos, you'll see that even though they're aimed at high school kids, I try to keep it casual, knowing that the audience is YouTube, and that there's a lot of people who, you know, don't read music and they're looking at this thing for the first time to understand what does somebody mean by a major scale, or what does somebody mean by an interval. So I try to use very kind of common sense language, approachable, casual language, rather than being overly theoretical. So you might check out some of those videos. And again, you can embed those videos in your learning system for remote learning.
All right, I have one more from Walter. Recruitment is particularly difficult right now, even more so than a regular pre-pandemic session or season. What are some ways that you employ techniques for recruitment?
Okay, so can I just, is Walter able to tell me if he's talking about like band and strings or, you know, what kind of ensembles is he, is this an ensemble thing or is this more just getting kids to sign up for elective classes, like things like music appreciation, music theory? What are we talking about?
He did say, by the way, my kids are elementary. I don't know if that's what you're looking for.
So I'm going to assume it's band strings, because usually at the elementary, you know, general music is a required class that they come to. It's one of the specials in some districts. It's called encores or something like that. But anyway, whereas
specifically band.
Great. Okay. And that's exactly what I do. In addition to teaching these high school elective classes, I am an elementary band director. That's part of my day, although I have been a high school band director. That's what I do. I recruit kids. And boy, our numbers are down. My personal numbers at the buildings that I teach are about 2/3 of what they normally are. And I even feel happy that it's only that, because there's just been some, you know, there's just been a lot of fall off in recruitment. So what we've tried to do is we created a website to share the instruments. We embedded, by the way, some of the Be Part of the Music and Scott Lang's, he has these great videos. So you definitely want to check out Scott Lang's Be Part of the Music. In the end, while Scott does have, he actually has like a service where they for free, you just type in your particulars and they create a recruitment website for you that you can use that they host. In the end, I felt like that didn't have as much content in it that I wanted to have. So I designed my own website, but I embedded the videos from Scott's. He puts them up on Vimeo and it allows you to you know, embed his content, some of that content, which are, like I said, they're excellent. He's done such a great service. So these really attractive kids are just showing you why they, and their parents are telling you why they like to play. And there's all sorts of research that you can embed about that. So that's one thing, is you can just get a good like portal to bring parents and kids through. I do think an in-person demonstration of instruments is always more powerful. So I will this spring, even though I couldn't do it last spring, this spring I'll be getting kids, even if it has to be small groups 6 feet apart, I'll be going in and playing instruments with my special wind instrument mask on and my bell cover, and I'll be showing the kids why these instruments are so cool in person. I think that making kids, the big picture is, above all, is you want to make kids feel like being in band is something special, like they're part of some really cool group that not everybody is in, and that's kind of exclusive, right? That not everybody can even do this, can play an instrument, but you can. And if you want to be a part of our band, you're going to get to do this, this, and this. So some of the things that on a normal school year I would do is have my students play at every single opportunity that somebody will let me have the kids play at a pep rally or play at whatever. I want to have my kids seen. So the first thing I thought of when the year started was, you know, we usually would do a winter concert and we're not allowed to do concerts. So I went to the trouble of figuring out how to do a virtual ensemble thing. And I made it more like a Hallmark Christmas special. I produced a video that I thought was an entertaining half hour of just sharing our kids at their very best. And, you know, the community seemed to really love it and enjoy. And now the kids are looking forward to doing something similar for the spring concert. So even though it's not like a normal year, I'm just looking for ways to make kids feel special so that those kids who aren't playing yet can look up to those fourth and fifth graders and say, oh, they're doing that cool thing, or they got that video on YouTube, or they got to be featured on our news show. So I would say just be as present in as many, you know, as many ways as you can, have your kids be seen and see you playing those instruments. And if you can do an in-person recruitment, great. You could use a website to push out a lot of great content and information and all the benefits of playing an instrument as well. And email me too. There's a lot more we could talk about, but I know we're running late.
Thank you so much, Scott. This was absolutely incredible. And the amount of resources you shared was incredible, so helpful. Thank you again for being with us today. Thank you, everyone, for joining us, and we will see you all next time.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Michaela.